Hello, good evening. I'm Nirav, and thank you for joining in to the panel discussion for opportunities in game industry and the changing games landscape. I have with me Samir Vittalwala and Piyush Kumar, my fellow moderator Yogesh, and we'll also have Anirudh join in shortly. Samir is the business director of Epic Games in India, and Piyush has been the founder and is the CEO of Router Sports and specializes in game streaming. Yogesh and I work with AWS, and we are technical account managers. We work with enterprise customers as well as work with game studios and help with their development. Thank you again for joining us today, and we can get started some of the discussions. We have some interesting discussions that we look forward to hear. Maybe we get started with you, Samir. One of the things that we see typically is a game studios specialize in a certain genre of games. You may be working with a few studios who typically specialize in building RPG content or MMOs. More often, some of these game studios also venture into they look at diversifying their genre, and they want to try out a different genre of games. What would be your advice to such game studios, game companies who want to diversify into a different genre? How should a game startup or a games company strategize before entering a new genre of games?
I mean, that's a heavy question, but because it requires a fair amount of understanding what the situation is at that time. Assuming you're starting from a place of success, this is a big assumption because most of the time, if you're going in for a pivot, clearly your audience hasn't. Kind of, you haven't found product market fit with that particular audience in terms of figuring out game loops. But assuming you're starting from a place of success, the idea is how can you franchise some of those characters and your MAU, DAU, WAU into another sort of category, which using elements of stories, using elements of characters, using elements of game loops, which you feel have worked well, but finding another way to kind of enhance that experience and to extend that audience so that they kind of move within another genre, but within the ecosystem of the IP that you already created. And that ecosystem of IP could be just, if you look at how Supercell does it by extending some of the core sort of, characters they have across Clash of Clans, Clash Royale, and then some of them get into Brawl Stars. Another good example of that is, our game, Fortnite. It continues to create new modes inside of a fairly popular genre, which is Battle Royale, but there's Fortnite Creative, there's Battle Royale. So these are other sort of mechanisms which, like for example, Fortnite Creative has no guns in it. Essentially it's the ability for you to kind of to be in a persistent world that has a really good social experiences, but it's not really a place where you come and you are trying to kind of get one up on somebody else within the VR genre. So those are just, in the time that's awarded, I think maybe just a quick sort of tip of how could look at, franchising your or within the genre, building new genres within your existing one, or building new titles which extend your IP.
That is a good point. If you already have a genre and if you've already got IP, extend it into a new genre, that is actually a good strategy as well. Do you think, and again, I think you already answered this part where you did mention that if there is a success, you've already seen success with one of your titles, and that is actually a good approach, a good time for you to go in. Instead of starting from scratch and actually trying multiple genres, you should focus on one genre and see success in that, then diversify. That makes sense. Yes. Thanks. I'll move over to Piyush for another question. Piyush, video game streaming has always been a key area, I mean, in esports, and it has been helpful in engaging the followers and fans for esports esports titles, tournaments rather. Are there any challenges with esports streaming in India today? I mean, the game developers could think of any opportunities, anything that you can point out to them where esports lacks today?
Yeah, okay. Firstly, thanks, Nirav and Yogesh, for the opportunity. Sabir, good to meet you here. No, I think from the perspective of where streaming business stands in India, I think given the fact that India works on multiple macro trends, at this stage in India, the two macro trends that we see around is gaming and content. Okay, so either we see people playing some or the other game, or we see them consuming content in some different formats. Right, and that is one situation. I'm just firstly trying to, you know, bring up the point about streaming or game streaming in general. And I think game streaming is actually an opportunity which is at the cusp of these two macro trends, right? I mean, the fact that millions of people are playing games and they want to consume content gives us an amazing opportunity to build the game streaming industry in India. Go ahead, please.
No, sorry. The video froze for me. I thought it was at your end. It was probably at my end. Sorry about that. Please continue.
Okay. No problems. And that therefore gives you know, all of us at Router an amazing opportunity. We have been building our game streaming product for the last almost 18 to 19 months. Have seen through the phase in which, while we entered, there was a PUBG and there was a Free Fire and multiple other games, and then how PUBG got banned. It came back as BGMI. And for us, the most important thing is to create a platform which is very democratized for all the games. We believe that these are very, very early days for the gaming industry. And we therefore want to be a platform that gives all kind of opportunities to all games and all kind of gamers and esports players or streamers, right? So that's one part of it. Coming to your question on esports, I think in India, the streaming business is building the gaming industry in two different ways. One is, of course, the streaming part where there are multiple streamers who are playing different games and who are streaming and creating their content on platforms like Router, Loco, YouTube, and few other platforms. That is growing very, very fast, and that therefore allows us to... I mean, for us, the key focus is to do two things for them. One, provide the best technology for them to do mobile game streaming with as much ease and with as much good quality as they can. And second is give them a lot of viewers. And within those viewers, create that engagement. So that is one focus. On the esports front, we have particularly seen over the last 6 months, the market has started to develop very, very well. We are looking to work together with all the publishers, all the game developers to see how we can add value to that. So on esports, the way I see it is that these are early days. These are very early days on for us to see how things will pan out. Slightly early days in the way streaming is, okay? And on esports, therefore, we are trying to do two things. We are trying to do multiple esports tournaments ourselves. But most importantly, we want to be the streaming partner for almost all the esports companies in India which are looking to conduct tournaments. We want to give them the audience much beyond what they'll probably find on platforms like YouTube, Facebook. I mean, we are okay to do it together with them because the idea is that we all need to develop this industry. So that's my limited view on how, I mean, we see this industry from the side of content, and we think this is a great, great time to be here.
Agree. I think that's a valid point, and good to see that you are partnering with the developers. That basically brings in the design elements in the right way so that they are ready for streaming on Router. Excellent. Yeah. Yogesh, I think you have a question for Piyush.
Yeah. So Piyush, on the next set, right? Like, what I wanted to know was like, how should Indian game studios think about leveraging any new opportunities that might come in space of, let's say, metaverse or NFT-based play-to-earn models, right? What would your advice be there?
So I think from a metaverse perspective, I think, again, I see these as early days, but I think given the way that we are also trying to work on multiple content formats so as to see that how we can bring in a sort of a different dimensional experience for content. Okay. So I'll have to admit that things are a little early at this stage. But for sure, when we are thinking of 2022 and 2023 and time to go from here, we need to start thinking from a metaverse perspective of what we can do together with game developers too, so as to bring that particular experience. From an NFT perspective, see, it's very, very clear. We are a content platform. There are millions of content being created by different creators on our platform. And we definitely want to provide the opportunity for all creators to create, buy, and sell at the same time NFTs, right? So we are working towards it. We are working on different models of how we can provide that kind of an opportunity to content creators. But our attempt, and this is where Router stands very clear on our thesis on the space or our ideology in the space, that the space needs to be very democratized. Okay, so for us, it is not just about creating opportunities for, say, the top creators or top streamers or top players. The idea is that how can we do it at mass and therefore give an equal opportunity to all kind of streamers and all kind of gamers to sort of do it. But NFTs are particularly something that we see should start to play from next year. And we all need to be prepared to get started with that.
Great. Nirav, I think you want to go?
Yeah. Sure, I can. Thanks, Piyush. Sameer, pun intended, Fortnite has been an epic last man standing game and has been popular with Indian and global players. In addition to Fortnite, we also see a trend of new games in the same genre which have actually sprung up. The Indian gamer has acquired the taste for the Battle Royale format of games. And where do you see, or what are the contributing factors that you see for the success of this genre in India? And can you share any epic learnings from this that indicate what other genres of content will catch up with Indian gamers next?
I think Battle Royale has been a global sort of hit. It's not just been an India specific hit.
Correct.
But, there are elements of that, I think, which resonate with anybody who's kind of been playing games since the early 2000s, is that you had sort of shooter genres like Counter-Strike, which is now CSGO. You've had, many others, including Call of Duty, which had seen quite a lot of success, especially in PC. I think the big enabling factor and the big unlock has been the ability for these games in multiplayer, in these large open world environments, to be played on mobile. I think that's really been the sort of, it's understood already that a lot of these games have a ratio of audiences which is very heavily male skewed. And being a shooter that I think continues to do well, but we are if you look at outside of the ecosystem if you look at the larger ecosystem, you've had other games like Genshin Impact, which have kind of grown on the Android charts as well as the iOS charts in India really rapidly. You've had a whole bunch of indie developers, which include the likes of Ludo King and others, which are beginning to do so. But generally, I think the idea that it's just a hyper-casual and a casual market, it very much is, and it will continue to be. But I think a lot of that audience is now feeding into the mid-core and the hard-core, into what is increasingly being looked at as the mobile AA and the mobile AAA audience.
Any upcoming genres that you think will catch on, in the sense, what do you see is challenging an Indian gamer? What is the next challenge an Indian gamer would like?
I think the jury is still out about what that would look like. I think generally there is a lot more confidence in developers that if they build something which is of a kind of ambition of a mobile AA, or a mobile AAA, there is audience readily available for them. We've seen that success not just with sort of some of our titles, but also with the larger Battle Royale genre. I think that good part is you need a hit or a couple of hits like that, which open up the whole market. And then suddenly you have the ability for people who, want to try new experiences, or at least just an acknowledgement from local developers also to say that, you know, wow, we could aim for that. We don't really have to limit ourselves to just being a hyper-casual or a casual, or we don't even have to limit ourselves to exporting from India to a global market. We can win here and then hopefully go from here to some other regions.
Excellent. Thank you for that, sir. Samir? I think, let me take a question for Yogesh. Yogesh here works out of Bangalore and works with a number of our customers in AWS who are in the fantasy sports genre. Yogesh, Indians have lapped up the fantasy sports genre. It is very popular. The strongest USPs that I see are tapping into the massive popularity of games like cricket, one of the most important, it's a religion in India. Aligned with the major events, alignment with the major events like IPL, World Cups, and basically cultivating and developing the market for the format, generating that interest, creating that that craze for it. And they've also had simplicity of making microtransactions on the platform that also kind of contributed to all of this. While these are success stories, there are definitely challenges that these fantasy sports companies, startup.
Hey guys, is it just me or has
his camera is frozen here?
Yeah.
Okay, I think it's back.
I think it's back. Yeah.
My bad. Sorry. Do you see any top challenges that fantasy sports startups and companies experience?
Sure, Nirav. So, like we all know that, you know, fantasy sport is definitely has like it garnered a massive following in Indian amongst Indian cricket enthusiasts, right? So, if you look at some of the interesting numbers around that, like for year 2019, I think the total number of users that were acquired were around 90 million, as per one of the studies done by the Fantasy Sports Federation, and in addition to that, I think for 2022, the projected number is around like $2.5 billion of revenue from fantasy sports, right? Now, having said that, the typical challenges that I have seen, like I would probably like to call out three of them. One being in the area of, handling the capacity to scale whenever there is a major peak event, like be it, your IPL or World Cup T20 like tournaments, right? Which draw high traffic to the platforms. And without necessary preparation or due diligence done, these platforms may struggle to handle the load, or the company may end up overspending while provisioning the infrastructure to absorb the load. So it becomes very essential to have a smart scaling strategy in place so that a right balance is maintained between your provisioned infrastructure and you do not incur additional cost at the same time. So the next area I think that becomes essential is mostly around, during these key events, we see that this becomes one of their major time where they make most of the annual revenue, right? It amounts to a large percentage of their annual revenue, which is well known for, across the users, good and bad both. Like if we are talking about malicious users, they take this as an opportunity and try to cripple the companies, right? Typically in the order of, like, they go for hunting vulnerabilities and start launching attacks, which could lead to either, let's say, outages or, induce scale out of the infra facing, a huge amount of financial losses, right? So it is, again, imperative here that, the companies, the platforms actually come in and take a look at first securing all of their internet-facing infrastructure. And then at the same time, they also would need to develop a long-term strategy to kind of, prevent any intrusion or DDoS or any similar attacks. The last one that I want to call out here is mostly around, from the business angle, right? So while we know that fantasy sports is a skill-based game, it's classified as that way as per the law of the land. From the business standpoint, it's been seen like time and again, the changes to the law at both at the center level or state level need the apps to adhere to these changes very quickly to be compliant. right? Now, if you take an example, an app might need to just block or allow the game to its users within a certain geographic area, like a, you know, a specific state or maybe a couple of states in the region, right, as per the new law. So this means that the app's architecture really need to cater to such requirements so that, you know, changes are pretty quick and they don't involve longer or complex build and release cycles. So, yeah, these are like, you know, some of the top challenges that I've seen, you know, amongst our customers who basically build and operate on and with us.
Nice. That's interesting. Thank you. This does overlap with some things we are seeing across other genres as well. So definitely fantasy sports are also inheriting the same kind of challenges. Okay. Interesting. Yes. Yogesh, I think you have a question for Samir.
Yeah. So Samir, like for decades, we have seen that games have AI, you know, built in them to improve player experience, right? As well as like it helps during the game design, like for example, Unreal's Meta Human Creator, right? So how do you see the game engines evolve to help developers build even smarter player experience leveraging AI?
Sure. You know, you've got behavior trees, navigation systems, query systems that can become aware of the environment and all of that. And this is all generic game-related stuff. But what could get interesting is also AI that can generate NPCs based on player behavior. Meta humans are fundamentally built by scanning thousands of real-world human beings and running AI algorithms to generate humans that could be used in game. World building also uses a lot of AI to fill in gaps in the original data. I know you've had tools like Photogrammetry is fast being used to generate assets, and AI plays an important role in filling in procedurally generated worlds. And then lastly, you know, player difficulty levels are also being determined through machine learning and AI, depending on how the player plays the game, adapts. Racing games are a good example of that. AI cars change behavior based on how the player plays so that the game becomes fun for players across all spectrums. So I don't know if that kind of gives you a good overview of how it's kind of evolving.
Yeah, definitely.
Excellent. I think I can go next.
Sure.
Yogesh, is that okay? Yeah. Thank you. Piyush, where do you see the next stage for your stream viewers? What steps would you be taking? What steps would Router be taking to convert your viewers into a gamer and then eventually into a streamer?
Yeah, okay. Very interesting question. Again, something which is a very important part of our DNA as a product. So one of the things that we did right from our initial days was to build one unified app for everybody who's downloading our app. Okay, so when I say one unified app, what it means is, pardon me, some throat issue. Yeah, so what it means is that we wanted to provide all the UGC tools within the same app that they're consuming the content. Okay, so we are in fact a very different player, in fact, most differentiated player in the category at this stage. That when you download Router, we allow each and every person to either upload a content or create a content using the streaming features. Okay. So the way we see this particular, you know, area evolving is that we will, you know, the success of, I mean, I not like to say that the entire gaming industry, but the success of streaming industry in India definitely depends on how many number of creators we can create together over the next couple of years or maybe next 3 years. It cannot just be done by the current, you know, top 100 or 500 streamers which are there in India. It needs to go into anything between 100,000 to 1 million. If you look at each and every content category that has succeeded in India, I mean, the last one that we all saw was the short form video content led by TikTok and now with so many other content players. They, I mean, particularly TikTok, I will have to give credit to them. The way they worked relentlessly by providing different features, by working on the community, by giving them tools, by giving them monetization opportunities to build that, led to now what we see is our four different unicorns in the space, right? And we'll see multiple other consolidation happen. I think there is no other way to look at streaming industry other than that that we need to focus on building the next set of streamers, which basically means we need to give them all the tools, we need to encourage them doing it. So the way we do it at Router is very simple. We look at our content structure into a pyramid. So the bottom of the pyramid is basically UGC, UGC content or UGC, players who are coming in, who are creating that content. So we encourage people to create content, become a part of our gamification. We try and give them users, so on and so forth. They graduate to an amateur streamer, and from there they graduate to a professional streamer. So that's the structure we follow. And we've seen amazing results so far in that.
Nice. Democratizing the viewers. That's excellent. Yogesh, do you have a question?
Yeah, sure. So on the growth of game streaming and creator economy, like how you explained just now, right? I think that's as you mentioned, rightly, right? It's a systemic driver for gaming also. So what trends do you see there on the creator side, and how does India's streamer ecosystem differ from that of the other markets?
Okay, great question. So I think there are clear, first let's take the second one first. Indian streaming market is very, very different. I mean, at least on Router, and I've seen mostly even on YouTube and different platforms, we don't see Indians are very crazy about international streamers, okay? The market is, or the gamers or the viewers are very crazy about Indian streamers, okay? So that is one clear, I mean, unlike many other content space where we would perhaps see an international player or international, content creator doing well, in gaming it is very, very India-centric, okay? Also, we have not seen English as a language at all used. In fact, there are far and few. Hardly maybe few of them use English. Otherwise, it's primarily Hindi and the regional languages, right? The other thing we have seen is that in gaming, particularly from a streaming perspective, the language communities are very strong. Okay, so if we, for example, have a strong streamer or a big streamer from say a state like Tamil Nadu, the kind of following he has within his own region is extremely strong. And he has a very core base that moves with him and that engages with him. Okay. So we have also seen that language centric engagement. So for example, if I onboard, say, a very strong set of, streamers from, say, a language like Kannada, right? We would not see a Hindi audience engaging with them as much as we'll see a Kannada audience, okay? That's because the language and the audio plays a very important role over here, and there are no language translation that is happening in real time. So from a streaming perspective, whenever we look at a new language, we definitely look at getting those viewers in. Okay, so if, for example, we are giving an opportunity or a certain language streamer is joining us, we believe it is our responsibility to get his audience on board and so as for him to get more engagement. So this is one. The second part is very simple. The other thing that we've seen clearly is that the engagement which happens between the viewer and the streamer is very high in India. Whether it is the form of gifting or stickers or a few other things that they do, or even the comment section. Even from the streamer perspective, we created a feature called Fan Leaderboard that allows streamers to gift coins to the viewer, okay, in real time. So it's actually an algorithm based rank rather a sort of a table which is there for the fans, and they get gifted as they come out as a key streamer. So the relationship and the engagement between streamer and the viewer is very strong in India. And for us, we continue to develop different features for that relationship to become stronger. And this is very unique to India. I mean, in a manner that it's not one way. In India, it's two ways. And both acknowledge that they are both important for this.
Great.
Nice. Thank you.
On a similar note, I think I'll go for the follow-up question.
Sure.
For Piyush, right? So, besides ad revenue and in-app purchases, which other lucrative monetization streams would you recommend for game studios to explore?
You're asking me to suggest for game studios or for streaming platforms? You're saying game studios.
From game studio standpoint, have you seen any trend around that? What would work well for them?
No, I think I think from a game studio perspective, what we have definitely, what we see is that the engagement that they get on a certain game is very, very important. One of the things that I definitely see as an upcoming mode is how game studios can develop a sort of a marketplace within their own experience, because with social commerce coming in, the commerce opportunities are now very fluid, right? So if content can drive commerce, so can gaming studios, right? It's just about somebody thinking about the right opportunity to be able to provide that, and that therefore I feel is an interesting opportunity. I mean, I haven't really come across as a very strong example, but I truly believe that gaming commerce is a very important part of something that we all are building will sort of merge with each other. The other part is, of course, the entire gifting model. Okay, I think if we can build a sort of a platform where the exchange between the gamer and its followers or different ways that can be done, that would be very interesting. What I mean is a collaborative kind of a feature that can allow different people to trade with each other or sort of play with each other can actually open up. Besides that, I think India is still a huge B2B advertising market, which basically means we have seen a lot of brands, a lot of new age brands, startups, different apps looking at us in a very interesting way. Fact is that the age group that gaming industry caters to, which is 10 or 12 years going up to 24 years, is very unique. Okay, if a brand or a marketer had to look at this age group, they have no option but to come to gaming opportunities, whether it is a streaming business or a developer or esports or whatever, right? And imagine, I mean, edutech is a great trend in India, and then there is gaming, right? Perfect marriage we have seen. We work with a lot of edutech companies, help them get users, etc. So we definitely feel that the kind of audience gaming can provide to other businesses, particularly in our age group, is going to be very unique. And we constantly need to evolve to give them ways to get that. That I think will be a great challenge.
Excellent.
Great.
Thank you. I'm going to take a question from the audience. This is a question for you, Sameer. The question is, they are really interested to know the scope of P2E gaming in India. Are you seeing a lot of trend in P2E play to earn games in India?
I don't think we have seen a lot of breakout titles right now. I mean, there seems to be a lot of interest in it, but we haven't seen anything come out yet.
I mean, Axie Infinity was a great example where that's kind of the one which people tend to provide and always give an example about. But definitely, it's not an easy model to build as well as exploit. Okay, so thank you for that. Understood. There is one other question, but I'm not very clear about the context there. I have asked a response in the comment, but let me just pose that question in case you have a better idea. The question, Sameer, is what is the future of open world genre in Indian game studios and the tendency of adding inclusivity for Indian-based open world games? I'm not very clear about the transparency of adding inclusivity there, but is there something that makes sense to you there?
Yeah, I mean, I think the idea really maybe could be that when you look at open world games, how can you integrate Indian stories into it? I think it's just a matter of time with the size of the audience that India has that, you'll begin to see a lot of our narratives feed themselves into these global hits, which are large worlds or new seasons coming out of existing sort of games which have already established themselves here, which will weave Indian storytelling and mythology inside of it. I don't know if that was the question, but I answered it to what I thought was the closest approximation of that.
That is true. Open world, definitely, if you look at it, if you think about it from a from an Indian perspective, one of those easy hits is mythology. Bring in a certain way in which you've seen a mythological, you've heard about a mythological story, and try to build your world around that, and then have the player explore that as if he's experiencing that firsthand. So, yep, great. Amjad, I have replied to that. In case you have, if this does not answer your question, please feel free to respond to that and clarify what I've asked there. Yogesh, you may want to take a question for Piyush. This is a question by Suhajit.
Yeah. So I think he's asking mostly around the content creator's standpoint. So the question is what are your views in terms of diversity of games played by various streamers who are the content creators on the platform, right? Are they only mainstream games, or you see any different other varieties of games as well?
No, so at this stage, thanks for asking the question, Shubhajit. No, at this stage, we definitely see that the popular games are getting more traction in terms of the way streaming is happening. BGMI, Valorant, Free Fire, Call of Duty, there are a few games which are doing fairly well. And I think it's not because these are the only few games that will eventually be driving the streaming industry. It's because these are early days. And people are still learning the skills and still finding ways for different people to engage. Also, it is very directly proportional to the way the games are popular in India, right? So any game which is popular in India also invariably sees more content being created around it. Like for example, Valorant is a classic example. It pretty much grew over this particular year, at the beginning of the year to now. And we definitely see a lot of streamers coming over there. So, the opportunity for sure is... how we can, as I said right at the beginning of the session, that we strongly believe in democratizing this entire space, which means that we definitely are working towards and are also trying to find different ways in which we can promote more games. We also want to be a platform which gives opportunity to different games to develop creators, because we do believe that having more content around a game does give a good opportunity for those games to be more popular, getting more downloaded, etc. Right. So, but yeah, in early days, it's still skewed to the popular games that we see around.
Sure.
Thanks, Piyush. I'll take a question from Kedar. Samir, this is something we did talk about, but he's elaborating this a little. I also have a quick view. Maybe I'll start with that. So the question is, with NFTs on rise, I believe they would be one of the most revolutionary ways for game devs to make money, as their weapon skins, character skins, and entity skins could be made into NFTs, and even can be partnered with brands to make gaming more of a pathway to real and digital world connections. What are the views of the panelists on this? I think he's touching on the metaverse kind of side of things here as well, that's something which is great. One of the things, Kedar, that I would think, and I'm happy for all of us, if every one of us has a view, please feel free to share that. There is always a fine balance inside the game. There is a healthy game economy that needs to be maintained well. If you try to monetize each and everything, there is a chance, there is a possibility that you will have a disparity amongst players. You may have, you will struggle with balancing your game as well. So there are elements that you definitely want to monetize on. There are things, and you've actually brought in a great point where you could partner with brands and make a certain weapon which is branded by a certain brand. That definitely brings in a monetization strategy for a game developer. But there is always a fine balance of how much you should bring NFT into the game and how much do you really want want your player to feel. The player always comes in for entertainment, and then you're kind of giving him an engagement which keeps him coming to your game, as well as being keen to want to invest or pay and try to use a certain element. We don't want that it become a habit like gambling or something of that sort, which then needs an addiction control of sort. So there is a fine balance, I feel. Samir, Piyush, Yogesh, any thoughts that you would like to share?
No, I think you captured it quite correctly, Nirav. Nothing new to add to that.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I think from, sorry, Samir, do you want to complete?
No, that was it.
Yeah, no, I mean, I completely agree that I think at a developing stage, this is something which is a little scary thing to get in right away. But I think from a streaming perspective, NFTs can be used in multiple interesting ways, right? Which is in terms of overlays, thumbnails, different things you can do with audio, different content formats, etc. that can come in. Mm. So it just allows the creator or the streamer to be able to create different formats, and therefore it can multiply and form into something much larger. But I completely agree that we should keep the game development stage or games as pure as possible, because they are the soul of what everything in this industry is being around, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Excellent. Yeah.
Cool. I think there's one more question for Piyush.
Yeah.
So, Piyush, I think Clubhouse has taken off quite well, and Bharat from the audience is actually looking forward to understand, would a similar audio product or a service in the gaming space work well as well?
No, very interesting question. Clubhouse, it has taken off well. I mean, it is going through its own swings. We don't know where it goes, but is audio a big thing in India? We all know it is. I mean, clear testament that we all still listen to FM. It's been, I don't know how many decades, and radio is still very popular in India. No, I think from a gaming perspective, the opportunity lies with what Discord has managed to do globally. Is something that is, I mean, the way communities are built around Discord and the way discussions are led around Discord is huge. We definitely believe that, while Discord is a global product and it has its own success and it has its own features and different ways that it's doing, we believe that Indian platforms, you know, like us, have a huge opportunity to make the audio community building process much easy and much make this much more easy than what it is on Discord. Okay. And therefore, from our end, we have had audio rooms from day one. Okay. People use it for different ways. Sometimes we see about 25,000 audio rooms being created in a day. We are working a lot on that. And we have built few features, in which people can join streamer through our audio rooms and sort of do a few things, like there are features like Squad Play, etc., which is available. But most definitely, I think the entire engagement between streamer and viewer will become much more stronger if the audio part of the product can be made much easy to use and do it like that. But Clubhouse is a good direction.
Cool.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
I think I can take a question. This kind of is to you, Samir, but I think even Piyush, you may want to share your views as well. One of the things that we see, especially in a specialized in a niche industry like games, is it becomes difficult to find talented programmers, talented artists. There is a gap in the academia where we don't have the necessary skills being trained. We don't have people being trained in the skills that the industry can consume easily. Do you see this as something where the academia can actually play a better part in the steady supply of talent, talented game designers, developers, artists, everything?
Yeah, I mean, on our end, we've been trying to train as many people as we can in the use of Unreal Engine, but also the entire Epic Games tools ecosystem. We've been offering free training in the region, and we hope to continue to do so. So, that's our way of making sure that, the game developer talent at least has a fundamental understanding of knowing how to use the engine and the tools.
Yeah. True.
Yeah.
And it's also the basics behind using the game engine, which is mathematics, the game mathematics, that is as a fundamental, that is as necessary as learning the engine itself. Perfect. Physics and mathematics. Brilliant. Piyush, do you have any thoughts on that? How easy is it for you to find the right talent, or do you get the right talent and then have the ability to train them in-house and put them on the job?
So from our end, honestly, we are not into the game development space. So I think we definitely rely on Samir and everybody on that side of the table to really drive that particular part. Someday, if we could also contribute into that economy, we would love to do it. But I think we have our tasks pretty well laid out. From our end, from a talent perspective, I think there are two things that we are focusing heavily on. One is, of course, the creators. As I said, the key goal is to get to 100,000 creators and then to 1 million creators over the next 3 to 4 or 5 years, which will kind of revolutionize the way Indian gaming content or industry is going to go. Second is, how can we play an important role in esports? Helping people develop teams. There is a lot of work that companies are doing, but how can we bring in our element to develop esports teams, production, the entire content around it, the entire distribution around it? How can we promote that talent? And the opportunity starts from next year when Asian Games will have esports as a medal sport. Right, this is an opportunity for everybody in the gaming community right now and there. Yeah. So let's see. Again, very early for us, but we believe that the talent is around. There are a lot of people who are doing it. We just need to treat esports exactly the way we treat cricket in India, and that is the kind of talent which will win us much, many more eyeballs than what we see otherwise.
In a follow-up question, in that case, Piyush, what is the best way for you or your product managers to ideate and to come up with what features and what features and functionality should Router support for the viewers and streamers?
It's pretty simple. It's been a very strong part of our DNA from day one. One, we have a very strong product and community team. Who are, for us, every decision is based on data. We don't really take any decision outside of data. Whatever data suggests, we take on that. So what we've done from day one is we have a very strong beta group, which is working constantly with the product team, which therefore suggests few features. And most of the feature suggestions that actually come are dependent on different behaviors. So people who are using our product wouldn't even know that there are multiple features we are trying at different stages just as to see what can really work next. Right. There are multiple examples. If somebody has been using Router over the last 1.5 years, you would have seen that. So two things, of course. I think there is a lot of learning which is there in the way the product is and the engagement that people are doing with the product. And second, the beta group plays a very important role. And we, being a very strong product tech company, completely rely on them to guide us through the next set of features that we launch.
Okay. Cool. Just conscious of time, we are 50 minutes up. Any other questions you have, Yogesh?
Yeah, so the last question, Nirav, I would like to pose it to you discuss about how Australian market looks like, right? So from Indian games company standpoint, we know that there are like a bouquet of offerings that they have to offer, like be it in casual games, fantasy, or even in esports, right? And also streaming. So which of these things you think probably would be significant for the market in Australia and New Zealand?
Excellent. So Australians love to play video and mobile games. I use the public transport whenever I go into the office, and I really enjoy watching someone sitting next to me or around me playing a game. And I like to see the way that they use the interface, and that is something which I enjoy. Sorry, but that's apart from that. I have seen that they love playing video and mobile games. They also enjoy betting on sports and races. So it is a fantastic market. Aussies spent more than $3.1 billion in 2019 and more than $3.4 billion in 2020 only on interactive games and esports. This is data as per a recent report by PwC. Of that, in-game microtransactions were close to $1 billion. So you can see it's actually a serious market for most games. I don't see a particular favorite of a favorite genre because we have a very mixed crowd of gamers. Talking about esports and fantasy sports, so esports is also projected to grow substantially. And even though there are a few local fantasy sports apps available, I believe it is still an attractive market for Indian fantasy sports apps. They definitely can look at expanding to Australia. Furthermore, there is an important element I would like to bring in here is for game businesses, game studios, game companies, the federal government, the Australian government offers a sweet 30% tax offset scheme for studios that earn more than 500K. There are state governments, four of them, in fact, who have topped up that 30% with an additional 10 to 15% of tax offset. So this actually brings in a very interesting proposition to encourage game studios and game companies in the state. So that's really something encouraging, motivating for the game studios. With that said, I do think it is a very lucrative market to tap and invest into. So I would encourage Indian developers, Indian publishers to look at Australia.
Great. Thanks, Nirav, for that insight.
Brilliant. Yeah. There is one other question. Yogesh, you want to take this question from Akshay?
Yeah, sure. I think probably this would be relevant for Samir. So Samir, mostly from the Indian market standpoint. So what is the Indian government stand on gaming industry and monetization and basically around microtransactions, right? So while we know that we face central or state level government laws that keep changing. So what, according to you, are the challenges that you see mostly, around various genres within game in India?
To be honest, I don't think I'm in the position I could answer this because we don't have a clear view about, our monetization is all in-app and our view is limited to that, given the fact that collections happen on that end on in-app purchases for items. So there's not much, I think, given the purview we have, that I could comment on this, unfortunately.
Sure.
I think, that question, a lot of that is something which the industry definitely is working on. There are factions within the industry who are working with the government on that, but we have limited visibility or the ability to comment on that. Akshay, I think we'll take one last question. This is a question for Piyush. Is user-generated content moderation a big challenge, or is it not such a big issue right now?
Okay, interesting question. no, I think it's a decent enough challenge for everybody, for all the platforms. We have invested a lot. In fact, we are working with AWS on few of the technologies that we are using through you to provide a moderation for content creators to be able to manage ensuring that the content and everything that people are discussing over there is appropriate and people are not crossing certain lines. Beyond that, we parallelly also invest in few set of moderators who moderate most of the key sessions, right? So as to ensure this. So again, early days, we have already applied a lot of technologies and we want to work with multiple other players to see how we can sort of help in the content moderation. But I have to say this, that in gaming particularly, we have not seen too many aberrations when it comes to the kind of levels people cross to. It's a very cohesive sort of a community. And barring few odd instances that we see here and there, it's been quite a good experience. But being a UGC platform, we have invested and we will continue to ensure the experience doesn't get spoiled because of that.
Nice. I think we are on time. Any other thoughts or comments that you want to share with the audience, Samir or Piyush? Anything else that comes to mind?
No, I think this has been good. Thank you for taking out the time, Nirav. Thank you, Yogesh, and pleasure meeting you, Piyush.
Same here, Samir. Good to meet you. And Yogesh and Nirav, thanks for the time. And thanks to the entire team for the opportunity for us to get connected like this. And yeah, look forward to building the entire space together.
Sure, brilliant.
Thanks for your time, Piyush.
Thank you so much, Samir. Thank you so much, Piyush. Really appreciate your time and all your insights. I know some of these questions are out of what we can really speak on, but was really interesting to hear your perspective, your views on many of these. Really appreciate your time today. Thank you very much once again.
Thanks, everyone, for listening.
Have a wonderful evening further.
Thank you.
Thanks, bye. Thank you all.